final reading today comes to us from the letter to the Hebrews. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. And he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now God did not subject the coming world, about which we are speaking, to angels, but someone has testified somewhere. What are human beings that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now, in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside of their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them. But we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sacrifices and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You may be seated. I really first came into contact with this reading from Hebrews in seminary. You see, we had multiple worship experiences every day in seminary. On Wednesdays, we would have communion. Every other day of the week, we would have morning prayer in the morning and evening prayer in the evening. It works out that way, right? And in the liturgy of both morning and evening prayer, the first section is a little bit of sung liturgy, and then there's a couple lessons, and then a little homily in reflection to the readings. And then there's this bridge between the readings and the word into the prayers of the people. So you have a little liturgy and the prayers of the people, and then the sending. That bridge is this text, right? Now, I went to seminary when we were using the Green Book. Who remembers the Green Book? Some of us do, right? The ancient book of old. And in the Green Book, the bridge went this way. The person leading worship would say, in many and various ways, God spoke to the people of old through the prophets. And then the people would respond, but now in these last days, God has spoken to us by a Son. And then we would stand up and finish worship. It's actually on page 298 in the book, his morning prayer, if you want to check me on that, right? In many and various ways, God spoke to the people of old through the prophets. But now in these last days, God has spoken to us by a Son. See, we hear in the text this morning from Genesis, page 2 in your, in your pew Bible, if you want to flip to it, right? And in the beginning of the story, God speaks directly to humanity. God speaks to humanity, and humanity doesn't listen. Right? By chapter 3, which is on page 3, I think, of the we've stopped listening to God, right? Even though God was speaking to us directly. So then God decides to send angels to speak to us. The Hebrew word that we translate as angels really means messenger. So God sends messengers, heavenly beings, to speak directly to us because we wouldn't listen to God. And by chapter 6 in Genesis, humanity stopped listening to the messengers that God would send. So then God said, maybe I need to send humans to speak to humans. So then God began sending prophets to the people so that the people may hear in their own voices by their own people what God was trying to say to them. And humanity didn't listen to the prophets, right? So for thousands of years, this was our destiny, to not listen to God. So then God decides, well, we're going to go back to the beginning, and I'm going to send a son, the divine, to speak directly to humanity. As the writer of Hebrews puts it, the exact image of what God expects from humanity, right? Here is one of us, a human, yet God's son, fully divine, to speak to us what God is trying to say. So God, once again, is speaking to us. Does humanity listen? Do we listen when God speaks to us? Right? Because the truth be told, God still speaks to us, the faithful people. God still sends heavenly beings to give us messages, right? My time here with you, I've heard from many of you stories of contacts with what you all believe to be as heavenly beings, right? Even as recent as a week or two ago, right? God still sends prophets today into our midst to speak to us. And the question is, do we listen for what God has to say to us? It's God's desire that we listen and hear what God has to say, right? That we begin to hear everything that God is telling us to do as we go out into the world, right? We come to this place, we hear the word, we receive communion, right? We gather with each other. We see our impact in the world as we are sending quilts out, near and far. Now they don't all have to go to Africa, right? God wants us to hear what God has next for us. God still speaks. God still sends messengers. God still uses humanity to communicate. Many times, those messengers that we get look like us, act like us, and in fact are us sitting in this room now. But many times, they do not look like us, and they do not act like us, and they are not people who sit in this room. And yet God still uses them to communicate to us. The question is, are we listening when they speak? Right? They may behave very different than we do. They may have different expectations than we do. And God may think that we have something to learn from people who are different than us. That's the story of this book, right? Is God sending different people to humanity so that humanity may learn how to be faithful. That's what the book's all about. God continues to do that so that we are continually opening ourselves to hearing what God has to say. And then you go out into the world and the world listens to you to hear what God has to say. Maybe you become the prophet through whom God speaks. Maybe you become that heavenly intervention that somebody encounters in a moment where they hear God speaking to them. Maybe you become the voice of God to someone who needs to hear it. We just become this conduit, right? Where we learn that it's Christ's name, the writer of Hebrews, the name that is above all, even the angels, right? That is the name we are called to proclaim. Not anyone else's name, including our own. And it's the gospel of Christ that we are called to proclaim in everything we say and everything we do. Not anybody else's, including our own. So in everything we say and do, we need to kind of ask ourselves, are we representing God and Christ and the Holy Spirit to the best of our ability? Are we listening to what God has to say to us? Are we bringing the kingdom of God to earth here and now? That's what God desires, right? I was saying earlier, the look from up here, right, is a beautiful vision of variety and diversity. And I'm not talking about the quilts. I'm talking about you. As you go out into the world, right? And maybe with a quilt. No, don't take these. We've got to box these up. Ann said, we've got to box these. Don't take these. Right? But you become this fabric that may wrap around someone who needs to hear it. You become the comfort of a message from God. You become the warmth of God's love for a world that needs to know the name and needs to hear the good news and needs to feel the love of God as you do. God trusts us so much that God sent a son as the exact replica of what is expected and desired of us. So that as we continue to follow Christ, we are promised and assured that as Christ sits at God's right hand, even now, Jesus leans in to the Father and whispers your name in God's ear as God's child, the beloved, in whom God is well pleased.